pastors there. I am not on payroll there. I am a volunteer. I am part of the leadership there. I do a lot of teaching for youth group for high school and also part of the race team also. Thank you. You guys are awesome. I mean, it's phenomenal to have such dedicated people within the church. Your pastor emailed me and said that they were going to be gone. And I can also lead worship along with doing the sermon. I kind of drug the field a little bit of a busy weekend. I was going to lead a game, but then I got this delightful email that they decided to stay back. And why it's so delightful to me is because by the time you get down here and you sing, you're not going to be here for the sermon. So, thank you very much for seeing that. I appreciate it. Today I'm going to be preaching out of 1 Peter, message about who we really are. So we're looking at 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 9 and 10. If you're using the Bible in front of you, it's my neighbor, I'm going to make it easy to look this up. And who we are. I told you a little bit who I am. I'm a farm boy from Plainview, originally from Plainview. A farm outside of Kellogg's. I have a wife and three great kids. Oldest one is a boy of 14, another boy 11, and a little girl is 7. There was a meeting they had at BS, and they just attended our regular worship at our home church at 9 o'clock, so otherwise they would have served them there. But that's who I am from the outside. And if you were to ask, who are you, you'll have similar answers. Your name, where you were, what you do, your hobbies, where you live, and so on. But what I'm truly asking you is, who are you? What's your identity? Not the outward. Granted, we're judged by what we do for a living, what our house looks like, our vehicles. And that's not how God created us. That's not who we really are. And the reason why I ask that is that it's a very difficult question sometimes to answer as far as who you are, your identity. Sometimes we don't know. Other times people are not who they think they are. And that's probably the most common thing nowadays in today's society. The reason why this is happening is, you may or may not realize this, but there's a spiritual warfare going on. And this warfare is on for each of our identities. Satan has waged a war against who we are and how God has created us. The reason why he's done this is Satan can't make things, he can only destroy things. And Satan cannot physically hurt God. But you know what he does? He goes after God's precious things, his children. He goes after us, he messes with their minds, he perverts, he destroys, he distorts who we are as people, who we are as Christians. And how he does this is extremely tricky. He tricks each and every one of us. What he does, he uses other people. Now, obviously, he uses them. So, you know, people, everyone has someone who doesn't like them. They're going to say things to you that aren't true. They're going to say things to you to persecute you, persecute your faith. And that's on a daily basis. So, they try to make you question God, question your faith, question who you are. But Satan is a lot more even more tricky than that, is he uses people you least expect. He may use your parents, other family members, teachers, and unfortunately sometimes preachers. People you wouldn't expect. And here's the thing, these people won't know that they're doing it. They don't know that they're doing it at all. Interesting study of 2012, this goes out to your parents, and I tell you, when I read this, I opened my eyes. Average household, a parent makes 10 comments towards their kids. And out of those 10 comments, only one of them is positive. Think about that. I read that, I almost vomited in my mouth and said to my wife, listen to this, and I read it to her. And if you think about it, we're pretty quick, you know, we want to guide our kids. We want to guide them in the right direction. And sometimes we don't communicate that well enough with them. What we're doing is we're putting inaccurate thoughts in their mind. You know, friends, they'll tell you what you should be wearing, how you should be dressing, what you should be doing. And of course, enemies, they're always after us. Satan will use, you know, hurt and pain, these types of emotions to change our identity, to skew it. You know, if he can make you resentful, bitter, ashamed, angry, guilty, that ultimately can change who you really are. Obviously, he uses the media and the culture. If you watch the news, read the paper, look at the advertisement, so on. You know, you're too fat, you're too skinny, you're not smart enough, you're a loser, you're not going to amount to nothing. Those are all the things that are coming at us. God's not real. You're not going to accomplish anything in ministry. You're not smart enough to go to college. You're not smart enough to do that for a living. You don't wear this, you don't drive that, so therefore you're not successful. That's what we're hearing and seeing all the time. And that's where Satan gets us. He gets in your mind. You know, he has you thinking that you're worthless, or that the sin that you committed cannot be forgiven. That you're not worthy of the grace of God. You're not worthy to come to the church. You're not worthy to serve in the church. And the biggest way how Satan uses all these thoughts and ideas that are around us, that he has us replay it in our mind until we believe it. If you think about it, if I buy a new wardrobe, and you walk into a church or wherever it may be, and you have five people say, boy, that looks great. But you look great. But you have that one person says, that may, you put on 5 pounds? That's not, no, that doesn't fit you very well, or whatever. You gotta replay that in your head. And guess what? You're probably never gonna wear that outfit again. Just for that one person. That's how Satan gets you believing that you are something that you really were not intended. So how do we know who we really are? How do we know what we should do for a living? Because, you know, there's a study out there that there's a lot of people that their career, their job is not what they really want to do. But at some point they're told they can do it or accomplish it. But how do we know? Well, I know it seems odd that I can stand up here when we really don't know each other and be able to tell you who you really are. But it's nothing I come up with. It comes with the Word of God. And yesterday's wedding, that family belonged primarily to the Assembly of God Church. Okay, so we got a little bit of different doctrine, and there's maybe a little different doctrine here compared to my home church. But one thing we have in common is that the words that are within this Bible are true and accurate. God breathed words. And this is where I'm going today's sermon. That's where I get all my sermons from. So you don't have to believe me, but it's in Scripture. If you do turn to 1 Peter 2, 9 and 10, I'll read it for you. And this has a tendency, well, what it has is the five fingerprints of your identity. Okay. But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, your God's special possession, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Once we were not a people, but now you are the people of God. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. So what are the five fingerprints of your identity? You're a chosen people, a royal priesthood. You're holy, God's special possession, and you are forgiven and receive mercy. So with that in mind, what does that mean? You know, how do we know this applies to us? And this philosopher, Blaise Pascal, he's a 1600 philosopher, he says this in the poem. Not only do we know Jesus Christ alone, but we know ourselves only by Jesus Christ. We know life and death only through Jesus Christ. Apart from Jesus Christ, we do not know the meaning of our life, the meaning of our death, or the meaning of God, nor the meaning of ourselves. It is only in Christ that we know this. In Christ. Keep in mind, the term in Christ is used, and this is the NASB Bible, 140 times in the entire Bible. In Christ. You know that the word Christian is only used 3 times? Twice plural, Christians and one singular Christian. When you see in Christ, it means Christians, believers, followers of God. Apostle Paul loves that term. Those who are in Christ, to be in Christ. So whenever you see in Christ, it means believers. That's us, is it not? We're believers of God. We're here. So that's how it applies to us. 35 times in the Bible, it tells us our identity, because you are in Christ, this is who you are. I'm just going to cover five very important ones, so you know who you are. First one is a chosen people. You're chosen. When you become a believer, you believe in Christ, God chooses you. You're accepted. You are all, every single one of you, you're accepted. Now, acceptance is a huge thing in our society. I mean, think back to the traumatization for us older people out of school, having to get picked for a ball game, whether it's kickball or basketball or whatnot, to choose your teams. And for those of us who are not as athletic as others, it was always an embarrassment or afraid you wouldn't get chosen and have to sit on the sideline. Guess what? You're already chosen. You're chosen. You're accepted by God because of His love, His mercy. We do not have to earn anything to be, or perform a certain way to be accepted by Christ when you're a believer. You are. You're in already. Nothing more to worry about. You're part of it. You can't get out of this acceptance because you think, you know what, this Christian thing is me. You know, I'm going to do life without God. And you walk away, that's what you're about to do. But just like a prodigal son, you didn't realize, I can't do this without Christ. You come back, guess what? The door's still open. You're already accepted. You're chosen by God. Deuteronomy will tell us, 7:6, for you are people holy to the Lord your God. He has chosen you to be His people, prized above all others in the face of this earth. Your chosen prized. Next one, a royal priesthood. Maybe a little bit harder to swallow, but hang with me on this one. You're all priests. I'm not saying you go into the Catholic Church and preach some sermon, but in the eyes of God, from the Bible, you're priests. Holman Bible Dictionary will say, you know, a Christian belief that every believer has direct access to God through Jesus Christ. Can you pray to Christ? Do you have direct access? And the answer to that is yes. That a church is a fellowship of priests serving together under the lordship of Christ. Okay, serving God? Yes, you are. You're priests. You're priests because you can have direct conversation through prayer with God. You teach others. You pray for others. It's a priesthood. Royal. The top. You're going to do the best of the best. God has made you a royal priesthood. So what does that mean? You're fully capable. You look at what is the most important thing in our lives. The Word of God. Most important thing. And our Father, God, has entrusted you with the ability to preach and teach His Word. You're capable to do anything you want in Christ. If you did want to be a doctor someday, and you set your mind to it, and you do it through Christ through prayer, you can be a doctor. You can do anything you want, and this is parents. Sometimes we have the ability to, nah, that's not you, you know, don't do that, don't go to this field, don't be a doctor, you know. But guess what? You think you can't do something, you're not going to do it. You think you can, you will do it. That's all there is to it. You need to encourage one another. You can do anything you want. I passed my classes for my associate's degree when I was younger, but I got in ministry. I'm not smart because I committed myself to Christ through prayer, work through it. Great. I'll lead for God. I won't lead not Him. You know what? And except for the fact that I can do anything I want through Christ, there's no way I can do that. No way. Anything you want to do is yours if it's in Christ. Don't try to do it on your own. You know, there's a difference between spiritual ambition and selfish ambition. Make her spiritual. With teaching and whatnot. God gives you the gift to do that. Romans 8:17 says, now we're children, then we're heirs. Heirs of God, heirs of Christ. If indeed, we share in His suffering in order that we may also share in His glory. We get to reign with God when we die. Right? And He says, hey, you're going to suffer. As Christians, you're going to suffer. As teachers of the Word, you're going to suffer. And you can do anything you want as far as teaching. You'll be able to work through that persecution. You'll be able to work through that criticism. No problem. If you stay in my Word. And guess what? That suffering you have here is going to pay for in the end. We all know serving inside a church can be tough at times. Especially serving outside of church is extremely tough. You guys have people that are fighting against you. Just centered as far as who is in control, and that's God. You can do anything you want, you're fully capable. A holy nation, you are holy. It's hard to believe the fact that we are holy, but if you look at, well, what does holy mean? Dedicated or consecrated to God for religious purpose. You're sacred. So guess what? You are extremely valuable. You have value. Each and every one of you has value. You see, we're separate from the rest of the world as believers. God's chosen us. He's accepted us. He put all the trust in teaching His true word. So therefore, we're completely different. We're sacred. Let's say in Ephesians 2:10, for we're God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do. Now, Apostle Paul knows what he's talking about. Workmanship, think about that. God created each and every single one of you individually with thought, handcrafted. So you're a property of God. We all know that a celebrity owns something that's worth, you know, a lot more than you and I owned it. Well, God is well above any celebrity, so what's your value? Think about that. Your value, you're extremely valuable, your workmanship. God put a lot of pride and craftsmanship. Next, you're God's special possession. What does that mean? You're loved. You're loved unconditionally. No matter what, God loves you. You're worthy. 7:9-17. The Lord your God is in the midst. He is a warrior who can deliver. He takes great delight in you. He renews you by his love. He shouts for joy over you. God has joy over you. God is delightful to have. Your presence in God's family brings joy and pleasure. So when the world says to you, you're too short, you're too tall, you're not smart enough, the clothes you wear, the style, your haircut, it's not common, they're completely wrong. You're loved regardless. God created you. He can use even your weakness for his glory. 7:13. Your biggest flaws, God can use that for his glory. So you are so very loved. So think about it. You're chosen by God. You're accepted. You're fully capable of doing anything through Christ. You're extremely valuable. You have value. You're loved unconditionally for who you are. The last one, you have received mercy, but you are holy. You're fully forgiven. It's hard for us to understand this whole forgiven thing, we're not very good at forgiving. Some may hear it and say you're forgiven, so on. But we have a tendency to kind of keep the citation in later on. That's not how God works. He tells us in Romans 8:1, there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ. You're not condemned. You know what that means? When you sin, you repent, ask for forgiveness, it's gone. It's forgotten. Oh, it's no longer there. All of us have sins in our life. There's a lot of us also that carry this sin on their shoulders daily, thinking that they're not worthy of God's forgiveness. That, you know, how can anyone forgive me for this? I'm having a hard time getting into heaven because God, you know, he's going to hold this over me. He tells you right there, no condemnation. That sin that's on your back, get over it. Get over it. God has. You don't even remember. He doesn't use it against you. You're forgiven. You have mercy. When someone says you're not worthy, you go to heaven, you're not worthy to be a Christian, God has forgiven you. You know, move on to the Lord and Savior has. But you think you have to dress a certain way or do certain things, your Bible can change your style to be accepted. You're wrong. You are already chosen. Chosen by God. He has accepted you just the way they are. If you're told that your goals and ambitions are unrealistic, don't ever listen. Don't ever listen. If you can do anything you set your mind to, Christ, don't get discouraged about God. Keep doing God's work. Don't get discouraged. Keep reading the Word. Keep discipling. God will give you the power to do it. Yes, you're going to get kicked around and endure that. But guess what? End time, you can drink it. with. And you're so very, very valuable, every single one of you. Very valuable. You're not a loser. You're not worthless. God doesn't make mistakes. God doesn't make any mistakes at all. The way you are is the way that God has intended. Don't let people try to change that. Don't let them change your identity, your thoughts. And you're so loved by condition, every single one of you. No matter what. Unconditionally, you're loved. You bring great joy to God and His kingdom. Your important asset is to His being, to His plan. You're forgiven. Like I said, that sin that you're dealing with, get over it. You seek repentance, and forgiveness is done. It's done. Join me in prayer as we close. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for our ability to praise and worship and learn about you in this body of Christ. Father, I ask you to bless this church and these people, to give them the strength and power to know their identity, who they are, to go out and disciple your word with great confidence, Father, and just keep us full of that armor to protect us against all of that warfare that's going on.